Hello students, in this lecture we are going to study magnetic fields. So iron has high Curie temperature, which is 1041 Kelvin, and consequently almost all the spins remains aligned at room temperature. Yet at room temperature, an ordinary piece of iron is not magnetic in the absence of applied magnetic field. Why? That was a question. So we know that when temperature is greater than TC, that is the Curie temperature, in this case the Curie temperature of the iron is 1041 Kelvin, and at this temperature the material should be in the state of paramagnetic state. Okay, so it should be in the paramagnetic state, but if the temperature is less than TC, so it should be in the ferromagnetic state. So it is expected that it should be in the ferromagnetic state. This is the theory. But if I have iron, let's say a piece of magnet, a piece of iron is there. So let's say this is my iron. So this will not be in the state of in the magnetized state. Why? Because below room temperature, this material should be in the magnetized state. So all the spins should be aligned, and we should get some magnetic field out of this piece of iron. But we were not getting this piece. So in order to explain this concept, this gave this theory of domain structure. So you can see here in the figure, in the first figure, he has given the theory. In the piece of iron, there are different domains, which are a region of space in the material, where all the magnetic moment vectors are aligned in one direction. So there are different regions, like here you can see one region, here also you can see one region, a big region where all the domains are aligned in one direction. Here also you can, so there are different regions where all the spins are aligned in one direction. So similarly you can see it here, there are spins which are aligned here. But if we, this is true when externally applied magnetic field intensity H is zero, but when we apply magnetic field H which is greater than zero, let's say, or less than zero, so when we apply some magnetic field, then in that case all the spins get aligned in one direction. You can see here we have applied magnetic field in this direction. So the energy of the, why this happens, because energy of the magnetic moment vector in magnetic moment vector in external magnetic field, it is given by minus mu dot b. So what happens, let's say external magnetic field is in this direction and domain is in this direction. So here we have north pole, here we have south pole, and here it will be south and north pole. So inside the magnet, the direction is from south to north, and outside, that is the magnetic move, direction of magnetic field. So if we talk about the energy, so if it is aligned along the external field, then the energy will be minus mu into b into cos of 0. So cos 0 is 1. So energy will be minus mu v. So if let's say it is aligned anti-parallel, if it is let's say in opposite direction, in that case what will happen, the energy will be minus mu into b into cos of 180 will be there. Cos 180 is nothing but minus 1. So minus mu b into cos 180 is minus, okay, so cos 180 is minus 1, so it becomes mu v. So energy will be maximum if it is in anti-parallel direction. So if this is the direction of magnetic field, the magnetic moment vector will align in the same direction, then energy is minimum, which is minus mu b. If it is in the anti-parallel direction, so it has energy mu b, minus mu b. If it is anti-parallel direction, in that case it has energy mu b, which is higher energy. So it will align along the external magnetic field to minimize its energy. And in the universe, whenever we have some certain process, that will proceed in the direction where the energy minimization is achieved. So magnetic domain is a region within the magnetic material in which the magnetization is uniform in direction. When cooled below the room temperature, called Curie temperature, the magnetization of a piece of ferromagnetic material spontaneously divides into many small regions called magnetic domains. So this is true below, you can say, Curie temperature. So below Curie temperature, if we apply magnetic field, it will align in the one direction. So in order to understand the movement of the domain, Here I have shown the pictorial from this reference 3. You can see in this reference book. So a moving domain in the grain of a silicon steel is caused by the increasing the external magnetic field in the downward direction observed in the Kerr microscope. While the areas are domains with magnetization directed up, dark areas are domains with the magnetization directed down. So here the Kerr microscope is, you can say, uses the magneto-optical Kerr effect, which means the rotation of the polarization of the light reflected from the magnetized surface. So you can easily see here, when we apply externally magnetic field, if we increase the external applied magnetic field, these domains, which was initially, let's say, white color domain was there, okay, so that domain moves and all the, you can say, region of space becomes magnetized in one direction. So these white color, you can say, spaces were there initially, okay, so there are, you can say, three spaces you can see, three domains you can see. So when we apply magnetic field intensity externally, that whole domain becomes aligned in one direction. So that is there. So one more effect that we are going to study, that is the magnetostriction effect. When magnetization of a piece of magnetic material, it changed, or you can say change to different direction, it causes slight change in the its shape. So magnetostriction is basically whenever, let's say, I have some this is, let's say, magnet, okay, let's say this is north pole, this is south pole, or some magnetic material, and if we apply external magnetic field to this material, its length will change. So change in length upon original length. So change in length when magnetic field is applied, okay, so magnetic field is greater than zero, and when the magnetic field is equal to zero, the original length, when the magnetic field is not applied, and into 10 raised to 6, that is given to convert it into ppm, part per million. So this magnetostriction is given as change in length upon original length. So in order to you can say actually calculate the magnetostriction, so we will cover this point first. The change in the magnetic field causes the magnetic dipole molecules to change its shape slightly, making the crystal lattice longer in one dimension and shorter in the other dimension. So you can see here there are different, you can say, magnetic moment vectors which are aligned in different direction. So if we apply magnetic field in one direction, all the domains will again align in that direction, and we will get elongation in that direction and contraction in other direction. That is the magnetostriction effect. So so in, let's say, I have some pellet. On that pellet we stick some material, okay, so I have strain gauges are there, okay, so these are small copper wires, okay, so it has 350 ohm resistance. So these are copper wires, and this is called as strain gauges, okay. So initially when we stick that material, it has a resistance of 350 ohm. When we keep this material, this pellet, with this can say strain gauge inside the external magnetic field, then the dimension of this pellet will change. If the dimension of this pellet is changed, there will be change in that, you can say, dimension of this strain gauge, and the resistance of this strain gauge will change. So change in resistance upon original resistance, this gives us the you can say magnetostriction coefficient that is generated in that material. Then in order to study the image hysteresis loop, okay, there are, you can say, image hysteresis loop, which we can see on x-axis we have externally applied magnetic field intensity. It is given in oersted, or sometimes it is given in ampere per meter in SI unit, and magnetization is also given in ampere per meter, or in practical sense, if we have vibrating sample magnetometer, VSM, okay, so in that VSM we use EMU per gram. So that is the unit. So once we let's say I have some VSM arrangement. So I have some electromagnets, so I have some sample, okay, so let's say this is my sample and this is a non-magnetic material, and at the top there is piezoelectric crystal which is attached over here. So this is your piezoelectric crystal, so this is piezoelectric crystal, and this is strong magnetic coils which are attached which are, you can say, electromagnetic coils. Okay, so when we attach these, when we apply high current to these electromagnetic coils and we vibrate this sample through this piezoelectric crystal, by applying some electric field to this piezoelectric crystal, the sample will vibrate up and down. Once this piezoelectric crystal starts vibrating, there are pickup coils which are here, okay, here and here. There are pickup coils. Okay, so you can see the structure in pickup coils are there. So this whole setup is called as vibrating sample magnetometer. So this is VSM. Why it is called vibrating? Because this sample which is enclosed by some capsule that is vibrating in between this electromagnet and pickup coil captures the voltage because of the changing magnetic field of the sample, and that will give us magnetization induced in the material. So piezoelectric material and this electromagnet and this sample and this whole setup is called as a vibrating sample magnetometer, and this sample vibrates because of this piezoelectric crystal. That's why it is called as vibrating sample magnetometer. So here, once we apply, okay, so let's say I have some this is time axis, and let's say this is voltage. So I have AC current which we have applied. So once we start to increase the voltage slightly up to this point, so magnetization initially it is zero, it will reach to its maximum value. So it will come up to this point. So at the highest applied voltage, so it will become saturated. Once we start decrease the voltage up to this point, so it will come back through this way. Okay, and at this point we have, okay, so at this point externally applied magnet voltage is zero. So voltage is zero at this point. So here also, the if the voltage is zero, magnetic field generated will be zero. If magnetic field generated is zero, so there will be some magnetization that will be remained in the material. So that is called as remanent magnetization. So we apply magnetic field in opposite direction. So now the sign of the voltage is changed. So it is negative voltage. So voltage in opposite direction. So and up to this point, so it will go in opposite direction. So at certain point, let's say at this value, okay. So at this value, all the magnetization which was induced in the material becomes zero. So if it is become zero, so corresponding to this value, whatever value is there, okay, so whatever value is there, this applied magnetic field intensity in opposite direction, so this field is called as coercive field. So coercive field is the field which is applied to nullify the remanent magnetization. If we further go with time, so at this point we have the highest value of voltage in negative direction, so we will get negative saturation over here. If we start to decrease the value of voltage, so magnetization will decrease, and if magnetization decrease at this point, magnetization is zero because the applied voltage is zero at this point. We reached it at this point, so we are at this point. So in the next cycle, when we complete the next cycle like this, so here once we start to increase the voltage up to this point, so we will not start from the origins, but we will start from this point and we will reach up to this point like this. So at the highest point here, we will reach here, and again we will continue this cycle. So in one wave corresponds to one loop is completed, ignoring the first loop. But we will, in general, we consider, let's say we have 50 hertz frequency. So in that case, 50 times we will get this curve in general. So the area of the, let's say here we will see, sometimes we plot MH hysteresis loop, or sometimes we plot BH hysteresis loop. So B is the magnetic field inside the material. B is equal to mu 0 H plus M. Okay, so basically this B is nothing but the magnetization, external magnetic field plus magnetization produced inside this material. So if we ignore this H, which is externally applied field, then B and M is the, you can say, same quantity, because so if I plot the MH hysteresis loop, let's say, So I will get only magnetization versus externally applied you can say magnetic field intensity. If I plot B versus H, in that case magnetization plus applied magnetic field intensity versus applied magnetic field intensity I will get in that curve. Some important importance for, to understand that importance, we will solve this problem. A transformer core is wound with a coil carrying an alternating current of the frequency 50 hertz. So 50 hertz is taken in order to okay, so this is the problem from the V. Raghavan's book, chapter number 16. So the 50 hertz frequency is there, that is the frequency in India. Assuming the magnetization is to be uniform throughout the volume core, and the volume of that core is given. So we have, let's say, a transformer whose core volume is given, that is 0.01 cubic meter, and calculate the hysteresis loss. Okay, we have to calculate the hysteresis loss. The hysteresis loop has an area of 60,000 units when axes are drawn in units of this and this. So if this is the axis unit and this is the axis unit, then we can understand this is BH hysteresis loop because this is the unit of B. Okay, so let's say I have some H on the X axis, B on the Y axis, and I have some hysteresis loop which is like this. Okay, so area under this loop, okay, area of loop is equal to, you can say, hysteresis loss. Okay, hysteresis loss. So we will calculate this hysteresis. So energy loss during one cycle we will calculate, which is area of the loop. Okay, so area of the loop, so we have x-axis and y-axis. So unit length in x-axis is given by 10 raised to 2 meter per ampere per meter, okay, that is H. Okay, on y-axis the unit is 10 raised to minus 4 Weber per meter square. So it is in, the value is B on the y-axis. So and the area of the loop, so if I want to calculate the area of this loop, so area of this loop will be okay, so area in units it is given 60,000 into x-axis one unit and y-axis x-axis one unit and y-axis one unit. So it gives me a 600 joule per meter cube. So 600 joule per meter cube is the, you can say, hysteresis loss in one cycle. So volume of the transformer core is given 0.01 cubic meter. So if I multiply it by the volume of the transformer core, I will get 6 joule loss in each cycle. So power loss due to hysteresis is equal to 6 joule into 50 hertz. So in one cycle, so I have told you, we have one cycle corresponds to one hysteresis loss, one loop. Another cycle corresponds to another loop. So we have frequency of 50 hertz. So here this is your time axis and this is your voltage axis. Okay, so as the voltage will increase, the magnetic field intensity which is applied externally, H, that will also increase. So we have equivalent H, okay, H versus T graph. So H will increase. So one cycle of H corresponds to hysteresis loss of 6 joule. So we have 50 hertz, means in 1 second there are 50 times this wave is traveling, or 50 times the polarity is changing. So we have to multiply it by 50. So we will get 50 into 6, that is 300 watts of loss in this whole process. So that is the whole about the you can say magnetic domains and the hysteresis loss that we have obtained by the BH hysteresis loss. So thank you for watching this video. These are the references which I have used to create this PPT. Thank you.